The vaccine rollout is hitting full steam in the United States. Hundreds of millions of vaccine doses have been delivered into people's arms. The vaccine distribution effort is crucial to addressing the COVID-19 pandemic. And to get those vaccine doses into people's arms, you need a good registration system. And to have a good registration system, you need good data management. Welcome, everyone. I'm Brian Jackson with InfoTech Research Group, and we have a special guest with us here today to talk about data. He's leading a data strategy effort that's having a real public impact. Carlos Rivero is the Chief Data Officer for the Commonwealth of Virginia. Welcome, Carlos.
Thank you, Brian.
And we're also joined today by InfoTech's Data Practice Lead, Andy Neill. Welcome, Andy.
Hi, Brian.
Carlos, let's start with you. Your office is playing a critical role in the state's vaccination campaign because you saw the need to introduce a centralized registration system. Vaccinate Virginia was launched at the beginning of February. Can you tell us about how you identified the need for that system?
The identification of the need for that system was very easy. When you have 35 different health districts, each running their own registration system, and then having multiple versions of those registration systems in play, it translated to about 72 different data sources that would then need to be integrated and managed on an ongoing basis to get a holistic view of what's happening in the Commonwealth. And that really predicated the need to like consolidate everything and have one centralized version of the truth.
Right. And once you knew that it was required, how hard was it to bring together? What was that experience like?
So the bringing together of the 72 different data sources, it wasn't difficult in the sense of the technical requirements of, you know, bringing data together, consolidating, cleaning, curating, standardizing, like all the same stuff we normally do. The problem is when you have so many disparate sources that were all developed individually, independent of each other, even though they're covering the same topics and the same data elements, the reality is they all collected it very differently. They have different valid values. So there's a lot of tedious grunt work that goes into that process to make sure that what comes out of the tail end of that is a clean, curated data set that is fit for purpose.
Andy, what do you think?
Well, I'm just going to ask a question actually around data mesh architectures, because recently we've been hearing a lot about data mesh architectures, you know, having that distributed model of architecture and it involving all the different components of the data architecture landscape. How does the data mesh architectures kind of change the game for you with your data portal? Because there's so many contributors here, it must be a bit of a challenge there.
It is absolutely a challenge. And for this particular purpose, where time is of the essence, we really didn't have the ability to leverage the data mesh architecture because it's just the time wasn't there, right? But we do have a data mesh architecture in our data sage environment. So our data sage is our secure analytics and governance environment where it's a more governed place where we bring in data assets. We don't actually bring them in, we virtualize them, right? So we virtualize the connection to a wide variety of different data sources. We implement governance layers on top of that. We have a whole middle layer stack that goes through all of the logic that's required when you have individuals that are requesting access to restricted use data, and then being able to facilitate that access. You have to have proposals that are submitted. Those proposals get routed to the right data stewards. Those data stewards then approve or reject, deny access to those data elements, and then that gets incorporated into the security model, which then facilitates the transfer of those data assets to those recipients, to those authorized recipients through that data mesh framework. But the reality is for this particular endeavor where we had, like I said, 72 different data sources, which were not going to be ongoing, right? So that's the key.
Right.
The fact that they were not going to be ongoing, this is going to be a one and done. You did this. Okay, fine. We bring it all together. We consolidate, clean, curate, standardize, all that wonderful stuff. Now that we have this one centralized environment, we then have to turn it around and say, well, how do we make the intelligence available to all of those stakeholders? Now we're talking 35 health districts, 133 localities, well over 230 individual users within each of those organizations that are actually planning what their vaccination clinics should be, who should be invited to those clinics, because remember, this is all closed pods, right? Making sure that only those that are invited to the clinics get the vaccine and get the notification. So having gone through that, because the architecture and the foundations and the governance models and the data trust framework that we already had in place, we were able to quickly leverage all of that to be able to build this out. But again, the data mesh really didn't play a role because of the fact that it was going to be a one and done. There wasn't going to be going back to that fountain to keep pulling those data resources from those organizations.
Yeah, sounds good. In fact, it's more actually that these days we almost want to leave the data where it is and not move it around too much, but have the dynamic ability to have the access and the security rights and the governance and the policy and the process. That's the bit that needs to kind of flex and change and accommodate where people need access to the data, right?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And that's, we spend more time on the people and the process part of this than on the technology part of this. And
right.
And I think that's really the take-home message is, you know, focus on the people and the process.
And it's interesting, actually, because nowadays the people and the process is the really hard part, because the technology is actually fairly easy these days. There's lots of technology and tools and that allow you to do whatever you want very quickly and easily. But getting people to change their minds from the institutional way of doing things is challenging, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And that rolls right into culture, right? You know, and as we all know from Peter Drucker, you know, culture eats strategy for breakfast, but it also eats technology and innovation for lunch and dinner, right? Because it doesn't matter how awesome your technology is, if the people aren't there to adopt it, it's not going to go anywhere.
Exactly.
And we were just talking about how much work it was actually taking for you before we started this video, Carlos. You were saying that you've been working almost nonstop and you're looking forward to having a real weekend again. But at least you must feel like it's been rewarding, that this is for a very crucial purpose that you're working towards.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean, at the end of the day, we're public servants, right? And we're here in service of the constituents of the Commonwealth of Virginia. So I want to make sure that everything that we're providing is fit for the purpose of the services that we're providing to our stakeholders and ultimately to improve the outcomes that they're experiencing. Because one of the things that we do a lot in my office specifically is looking at services and how they're related to outcomes. And that's a really important thing, because as you talk to different government agencies, and within the Commonwealth, we have 63 executive branch agencies, we're always talking about the services they provide, but then being able to link those services to the outcomes that our constituents experience. And in order for us to do that, data sharing plays a huge role in our ability to, you know, make that a reality, because oftentimes the organizations that are providing the service aren't monitoring the outcome, right? That outcome is being monitored by another organization. And a really good example that I like to give is social services, right? Services in the name of the agency. The Department of Social Services is providing a lot of different services to many of our most vulnerable population. But the reality is they're not monitoring the outcomes of those services. Sometimes those outcomes are, in the most positive light, a really good paying job. Well, that is captured by the Virginia Employment Commission in all of the data they collect from, you know, the salaries and the occupation types and the unemployment insurance and all that wonderful stuff that they get from the different employers in the Commonwealth. The flip side to that, a very negative outcome, is that they end up in the prison system, right? And so now the Department of Corrections has that information. And so DSS doesn't have access to either one of those different data sets to be able to tell which of their service recipients either ended up with a really good paying job or ended up in corrections, right? And so being able to tie all of that together and create an ecosystem where all of those data streams come together to provide that longitudinal view and that connection between services and outcomes is really one of the most important roles that I play within the Commonwealth.
It's actually a very important topic in enterprise architecture as well. Actually, attaching the business service to the outcome, like what's really driving value for the business, and then thinking about, okay, what data do I need to support those things? That's the right way of looking at things, because so often I see people launch into, let's look at the data, let's look at the applications. It's like, yeah, why though? You need to tie back to real value for the business, right?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at any of the, you know, architecture frameworks, they all begin with business architecture.
Right.
And that's always the hardest one to get, right? That's always the hardest one for the people to really get behind and talk about the business. They feel like, oh, we have this. No, you don't. Unless you're tying everything, all of your actions to the business value that you're generating, you're really not implementing the architecture framework the way it's meant to be designed.
What a great conversation. Thanks so much, Carlos.
My pleasure, Brian.